This episode of Standard Orbit is brought to you by Audible.com, offering more than 180,000 titles for smartphone, tablet, and desktop. To get a free audiobook of your choice and help Trek FM at the same time, visit audibletrial.com/trekfm. And also by Enterprise in Space, an international program for the nonprofit National Space Society. Find out how you can help science and education and become a virtual crew member aboard the NSS Enterprise Orbiter by visiting enterpriseinspace.org. Want to join the conversation and share your thoughts on this episode? Join the Babel Conference, our listeners group on Facebook. Just type B-A-B-E-L into the Facebook search field. We look forward to seeing you there.
This is Walter Koenig, Chekhov from Star Trek, and you're listening to Trek FM.
Risk is our business.
It's like nothing we've dealt with before.
By golly, Jim, I'm beginning to think I can cure a rainy day.
I can't change the laws of physics.
Now in standard orbit, sir.
Welcome, everyone, to Standard Orbit, Trek FM's dedicated podcast that covers the original and new cast of Captain Kirk and the Enterprise. I'm Zach Moore.
And I'm Haley Stoddart. And hey, guess what? We're back with Mr. Stephen Lance to finish our conversation from last week.
That's right. We're back with part two of our Stephen Lance interview. We talk more about his time living with James Doohan while he was working on Star Trek The Motion Picture, his experience on set there, including his makeup and all that good stuff, some anecdotes from on set, his time meeting Christopher Lloyd at a recent film festival, as well as many of the other things that Stephen has been involved in, including books and film festivals and things of that nature. So here we go. On to part two, Energize.
Yeah, the great thing about living with Scotty was because nobody, we would just do the voice constantly, him and I, and nobody knew whether it was Jimmy or me in the room. That's not true. I didn't. The most uncomfortable, unusual moment that I've ever had, maybe in my life, was I was in a room watching Star Trek one night with Jimmy. The room is set up, the living room. There's a couch, a sofa, and then in front of the sofa was a coffee table, and then a space, and then the television set. Well, Jimmy was sitting on the sofa by himself behind the coffee table, and Monty and I were sitting in front of the table looking at the set. And whenever Scotty came on the screen, Eric, who couldn't even say daddy yet, used to say, "Dida, Dida." And I told this to my kids when they were little. And to this day, my daughter, who was a dean at NYU University, calls me Dida to this day. And it's because of Jimmy's son. But the weirdest moment was, here was Scotty in front of me and Scotty behind me. And I so wanted to turn around and look at the expression on his face. That's all I wanted to see was, what was he thinking at that moment, seeing himself on the screen? And it was very much like a scene from the movie Targets with Boris Karloff, when he is on stage and on the screen at the same time at a drive-in theater with the sniper. Yeah, it's a frightening scene, but it confused the sniper, the shooter, because he saw Karloff walking towards him on the stage in front of the screen, and then saw Karloff walking towards him from the other angle on the screen. And then that's how Karloff was able to knock the gun out of his hand with a cane. And it was that kind of a moment when I was in between the real Scotty and the filmed Scotty, and it was a very, very surreal moment.
So you were in California to be in Star Trek Motion Picture. What was that like? You know, I mean, how many days were you on set?
A week of time. First of all, I was known to the people, including Freddie Phillips, Fred B. Phillips, who's the makeup artist, and Jonna, his daughter, who were doing the makeup, knew me. So when we went there, I think a day or so before the actual makeup and the filming, and met some people, and they knew I was on set. And when we got to the studio, you're in downtown Los Angeles on heavy traffic street, and you go through the DeMille Gate. You know what the DeMille Gate is? The wrought iron gate, you know? And you go through DeMille Gate, you know, they know Jimmy, so the guard tips his hat, you know, "Oh, please, you know, come on in." And then you look like you're on a plateau. It's like you get off to Los Angeles and you're on a plateau, and it's the most amazing thing you've ever seen. And it's this beautiful blue sky, and you look like you're 1,000 feet up, And it's a painted wall, which they use for outdoor stuff. It's the building where the props are. And the outside wall is painted with clouds. And it's 40 feet long, 50 feet long, the building. And then the parking, which if there's nothing going on there, you can park, but you have to park down at an angle, a steep angle, because that's where the water tank is that they filled up, where they had
the crash scene. Oh, for Star Trek 4. Yeah.
For Star Trek 4. So that's where they filmed that scene there in front of that wall. But in my movie, I saw one of the other exterior scenes when he's on Vulcan. And you know how there's that big, they have the scene, there's that big statue of the Vulcan hero with the red kind of,
with the feet,
red stone, the feet. So when you walk on the set, the only thing that is there is 1 foot. That's it. That 1 foot that the Spock stood near for the close-ups that they shot from a high angle, and everything else was a matte shot, a glass painting or whatever, the statue. It's not all. It was just so funny to see it's just a foot, 1 foot.
Out of context, yeah.
Yeah.
Way to ruin the illusion, Steve.
Yeah,
thanks.
Yeah, ruined it, but I remember. And there was no, we didn't have cell phones, and there's no cameras. I don't have pictures of me on the set or a picture of the foot. You know, it just kills you. The first thing they did was sent me with a little pencil sketch. I wish I still had it. It might be somewhere. A Xerox picture that looked kind of like Shatner, that showed the Star Trek official haircut with the pointed sideburns and I had long hair. I looked like Freddie.
Yes.
When I went to California, I looked like Freddie Prinze Jr. Now you can go to imdb.com and look up Stephen Lance and see me now. But I looked like Freddie Prinze Jr. And the first thing that the barber does is cut, my hair real short. Hmm. And then cuts my sideburns, the pointed, which I was so excited about, because now I was going to be able to come back to Freehold, New Jersey, and all my friends would see my pointed sideburns and know that I was in Star Trek. It was so great.
Starfleet regulation haircut. Yep.
Yeah, the regulation haircut. And I'm now, this is now, I don't know what day of the week, maybe Monday. And like Tuesday, we're going to go for costuming and then for like makeup, the Wednesday or Thursday. It took a whole week to do this. And I meet Freddie Phillips, and we're going in to do the makeup for the scene. And I said, "Hey, Freddie, can you make me a Vulcan? I have black hair. I got the pointed sideburns. I got my facial shape is the same kind of shape that the Vulcans have. You know, I have a long face as opposed to a round face. You know, I could look like a Vulcan." And Freddie said, "Well, we got enough Vulcans for the scene. You'll be a Bumphead." And I go, "What the hell's a Bumphead?" He said, "You are. Sit down." So the first thing he did was shave off my beautiful pointed sideburns, but not just shave them off, all the way to the top of the ear, because the plastic the application had a fit around underneath. So I had like no sideburns, which now has been kind of a style for a while, but back then to have no sideburns, like to the middle of your ear, was like all gone. And then they put on this plastic head, which was not cast for me. I'd love to say that they cast it and molded it and I went through all that procedure. They didn't. They were made for Billy Van Zandt, who was Alien Boy. And Van Zandt is Steve Van Zandt's brother. We met on the set, and he turned out to be from New Jersey, and we became very good friends and still friends to this day. But the makeup that I wore was not made for my head, but was cast from Billy's mold. So his head's a little bit different shape, a little bit bigger than mine. And it just was uncomfortable the whole time. You talk about having to walk in someone else's shoes. Well, I had to walk in someone else's head, and they put the bald wig on, and the hair is all, already in the rubber. And then Freddie is going around looking at the makeup, the Andorians, and saying a little more green here. And he's looking at the Vulcans and, make this sideburns a little pointier, the hair, make the bangs, more like a page boy. And then he comes to me and said, "Oh, by the way, Bumpheads don't have mustaches." And in 2 seconds, they shaved off buzzed off my mustache, and then put cake makeup on. Talk about pain. It was like that scene from that other movie, the actor, I forgot it, where they actually ripped his hair off. Remember, they were doing a waxing or something in a film?
Oh,
and
right.
They didn't tell him.
40-year-old virgin. Kelly Clarkson.
Right. Right. And it was that kind of thing where they didn't tell me it was going to happen. And then it just happened. And then they put the makeup on, and it stung like a son of a gun for y'all.
Now, for the listeners who may not can't visualize what a Bumphead is. This character, like you're talking about, you used his makeup, the same mold from it. But this is the guy on the bridge with like the glowing eyes and the Bumphead and the kind of mullet. And he's like the one guy who like likes Captain Decker. He's like, Captain Decker worked on this ship for 2 years. You know, so that's the guy we're talking about here. Visualize it, folks.
That's the guy we're talking. That's the guy we're talking about. You can see me if you go to the IMDb.com and Stephen Lance. If you thumb through the pictures, you will see the black and white shot of me, Jimmy, and Grace. And it's really special because when they were doing those publicity pictures, they were in kind of a rush in between scenes, and they wanted to get some publicity pictures. So each of the stars kind of posed with one of the special guests that were in this. David Gerald was there. Susan Sackett was there. You can look those names up if you know. Bill Hickey was there.
Yeah. The Tribbles were there. Yeah.
The Tribble. So if you Robert Weiss's Bob Weiss, his wife was in the scene. Also, Robert Weiss, you know, the director, Bob Weiss.
Right.
So each of the stars posed with one of them. But because I was friends with Gracie and she was friends with Jimmy, when they were taking the picture of me and Jimmy, Gracie was free and says, "Oh, I want to be in Stevie's picture." And I think I'm the only one that has a publicity picture shot from that scene that has two main cast members. I'm flanked by left and right by.
That's awesome. We'll make that the art for this week's show so everybody can see it.
Oh, cool. Oh, okay. So you'll put that up and everyone will see me.
Yes, absolutely.
You can see the difference in my makeup, by the way, Zach, is that nowadays, in that movie, if you blow it up real big, you can see a bump across the ridge of my nose. Because the makeup went from underneath my eyebrow, you know, underneath my where the temples of my by my ear, where the sideburns were supposed to be, and then glued in under my eyes. It was actually glued in underneath my eyebrow ridge, and then across the bridge of your nose, underneath the other eye, and then to the other side. And that's how they thought they could hide the line. And since I didn't have any close-ups except for that shot, it's okay. But they found that line across that bridge of the nose was still visible no matter how thin they tried to make the plastic application. So most of the aliens now, maybe all aliens, on every show and every movie have some kind of goofy nose. And and the reason they have this goofy nose is because the makeup goes like mine and then underneath the eye and then around the nose and then up the other side of the nose and then underneath the eye, and you never see the line. And that's one of the tricks
that's the fascinating
visually.
Point of trivia. I never realized that before, but that would explain the bumpy, funny nose of all Star Trek aliens after this in the shows.
The nose of the week.
So when you watch the film, can you see you like in the like is,
oh,
is there
yes.
is
oh,
there
yeah,
a, is there a way to point you out for all the viewers next time? Because next time we watch a motion picture, we're all gonna be looking for you in that crowd shot. So how can we find you, Steve?
Okay, and talk about pointing out. This is it. Now, I'm not really a method actor, but I did something which was not directed, which I was terrified to do because I thought I'd get yelled at and sent home. But actually, it worked. My favorite TV show, and don't tell the Star Trek fans, Star Trek would probably be second to The Adventures of Superman. I'm very old, kids, and I grew up watching George Reeves in The Adventures of Superman.
Yep.
And at the beginning of the show, they go, "Look, up in the sky, it's a bird, it's a plane." And one of the guys in the crowd points up, and then they show him flying over the building. So I'm there on a scene. They're showing us, by the way, while we were there, they showed us some slides of the special effect of what it was going to look like with the V'ger breaking up the space station. But that was shown on a screen where the blue insignia was in front of us. You remember where that blue insignia, you know, it's kind of it's not a rectangle, but it's kind of a curved rectangle shape. Yeah. And that's where they showed it. And then we knew what we were reacting to. So we saw that there was, and then Bob Weiss said that there's a space station is being destroyed by this alien force that we don't know what it is. So I want you to all now talk to each other like, and they directed us like that. So while we're watching it, I lean over, you look to the, when you're watching it, to the right-hand side towards the center, and you'll see me, the alien, point at the screen. Like, I lean over to the guy to, like, look at that, and I leaned over. Now, because I'm a good actor, I didn't just point, I leaned over to talk to the guy. By doing that, I blocked my head for the rest of that shot, because I'm an actor, and I wanted to make it I wanted to emote. I wanted it to look like I had a reason. I always have to have a reason to do something. And I did that in a Woody Allen movie. Maybe we'll save that for another show when I'll talk about Woody Allen and how I helped him direct one of the scenes. But I pointed. So you can find me pointing, freeze the frame, blow it up, and see me there in the crowd next to a Native American.
Star Trek, the motion picture. You did appear in it. What did you think of it as a film?
It was probably the best film ever to come out of Hollywood.
Well, Ken will love to hear you say that. That's actually Ken's favorite Star Trek film. So
really, there are people who have comments both good and bad about the film. Some say the fly-through V'ger was too long. Robert Weiss said, I wanted to show you how big V'ger was. And the scene, by the way, does not run as long as you think it does or feel it does. And that was his intention. And the other thing is people who say that William Shatner is not a good actor. I want to defend Bill as probably one of the greatest actors that I've ever seen and certainly had the pleasure to work with. And the fact is, watch the scene when Scotty takes him around the refitted Enterprise for the first time. It's called the flyby sequence.
Right.
Bill does not utter a word. There's no dialogue in that scene. And you watch his eyes and watch his face. And you know by looking at Bill that he loves this ship. And you tell me that that's not good acting.
I was reading your bio. One question I had, I wanted to ask you, where did you get your stage name from?
Which stage name are you talking about? Stephen Lance?
The Heesh or Hirsch?
Oh, the Heesh.
Yeah.
Right. Oh, that, it says that stage name Heesh. I have to, this is the old actor story, how actors change their names.
Yes.
I was born Stephen Lance Hirsch, H-E-R-S-H. When I was at college, a girl that I was dating made a needlepoint nameplate for my door that's supposed to have said Hirsch. And because she had never done needlepoint, the block letters of the R looked like an A. And everybody on my floor called me Heesh. And then when I hosted shows, and we used to do talent shows, you know, on campus, the acts might not have been as good as you had hoped they would be. And these jocks that were in my wing on a campus would yell, "We want Heesh, we want Heesh," and it just stuck. and that's how I became the Heesh. So eventually that wore off, and I just used my first and middle name, which I took from a lesson from Anne Margaret. Anne Margaret's name is Anne Margaret Olsen, spelled very Swedishly with Olsen, you know, if you look it up, and she uses Anne Margaret. So I use Stephen Lance, and it's my legal name. I mean, it was actually changed. It went through court thing. So I'm actually legally Stephen Lance. So if you want to use Heesh, or Stephen Hirsch, you go right ahead. No one's using it.
As someone who does needlepoint, and I'm still working on my skills, I can totally understand how she tried to do an R and it didn't look like an R.
It didn't go around. That curve part is hard because they're blocked. You're doing it in a grid, right, Haley?
Yep, you are.
Yep. So and she couldn't figure out how to use it. I mean, she was brand new at it and made me a lovely gift, and I was proud to put it on my door, but it changed my career forever.
And also, as someone whose name gets spelled wrong all the time, I totally get it.
Right. Stephen Lance, yeah, it gets spelled right every time.
Yes. I wanted to ask you about the book that you're working on. I'm really excited when I saw that you were doing about that.
I am doing, yeah, I have one book that's out, and if you buy it, you have to buy it on half.com or I get nothing. There's a book called Written Out of Television. And written out is a term used in show business where an actor leaves a show and then is replaced, like the Darrens on Bewitched, or I have all the Star Trek replacements from the original series and from the Next Generation also, where one week there would be, we called them the Ensign of the Week that was on the Star Trek till Mr. Chekhov showed up in the second
season.
The guy
sitting next to Sulu, right?
Right. And then how come they changed Darren on Bewitched? And how come Shelley Long left Cheers and replaced her with Howe, you know, Kirstie Alley, who, by the way, was in a Star Trek movie. So
was she in Star Trek? No.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, never mind. So that's what that book, So Written Out of Television is a book that's out there. I don't get anything for anymore. It's out of print. But the book that I'm working on, I want to call, it's called How I Saved Star Trek is the working title. And I know that that sounds, you know, tongue in cheek. It's kind of like what Bill did on that History Channel show, How I Changed the World. And he right. said at the beginning, it's not really how I changed the world, how Star Trek changed the world. And of course, my role hosting those conventions did have some impact in keeping Star Trek in the limelight, in the news. And I did play a role, a small part in keeping that fandom alive. And I do, but the real title of the book is probably not going to be that, but that's the working title. So the question, and I'm glad you asked it, is if anyone out there has attended those early conventions, and those are fans that are going to be in their probably 40s, 50s to 60s, even years old, that attended the conventions back in New York, 1974 was my first one, 75, 76, 78, 1980, 1981, 75 also we did one in Philadelphia. I think 77 we did one in Atlanta, Georgia. If anybody out there has attended any of those conventions, I want to talk to you because I want to hear what you remember, things that I might have done that were interesting or funny or something that you saw at those conventions that I didn't see because I was on the stage looking out at you, and I want to know what you saw looking at us. And the place to reach me is easy. Just go to Stephen Lance at the Juno.com. Stephen Lance, StevenLance at Juno.com. And please write to me, and I will promise to write you back. And if you write me,
we do have a lot of listeners who, you know, were around in that time period, and we'll probably have some memories about you and the experience there, some anecdotes, and that would be great to connect you guys. So definitely, guys, if you like you said, if you were at the conventions in the 70s, that was a little before me and Haley's time, to be honest. But if you guys out there were at the conventions in the 70s, please get in contact with Steve and talk some Star Trek, and hey, you might get some anecdotes in a book. We'll see. Have you ever gone to Star Trek Las Vegas, Steve?
No, I have. Unfortunately, have just. It's always conflicting with something that I'm doing. You know, a film or a voiceover or rearranging my sock drawer, you know, something is always conflicted, and I've not been able to make those, but it's on my list of things
that
to
would,
do.
You know, that would probably be really quite a great place to possibly meet some of those fans that were at those earlier conventions, and talk to them face to face, just as an idea.
We can talk about that. You guys have a booth there. Why can we can get together and I'll hang
we,
out.
We
at,
have
know,
a we have
out.
A presence there for sure.
We have a presence there, definitely.
Well, then I will. We'll talk about that for the next one, and let's say tentatively, maybe that can happen.
There you go, and it's a tax write off because it's for your research for your book, Steve.
That's good. If I do come to your booth, will I get a ribbon that says guest?
We'll give you a third place ribbon.
Okay. All right, I'm in.
Great. Well, Steve, a couple things I want to hit on before we wrap it up here. I know for the past few years you've been hosting blocks of films at the Garden State Film Festival in New Jersey, correct?
Yes, we touched on this earlier, and it's the Garden State Film Festival, and I've been doing this for a number of years. I've known these people for a while, but the reason that they finally grabbed me to be on the program was because of the For Love of Spock, and they had that film 2 years ago when Adam Nimoy had finished the film and said, would you host this film and then do a program, which I named Where One Man Has Gone Before, and then did a show after that talking about the same kind of things we're talking about and some stories about working on the set and things Leonard had told me or things that I saw Leonard do. And it was very, very touching kind of moment. Felt close to Leonard, and there I never met Adam, but felt close to his dad again at that moment, seeing the film and remembering him like that, like I knew him. And it's a wonderful film. I think it's on Netflix now. If you haven't seen it, please see it. Please write to Adam Nimoy and tell him how much you love it. And it was great. So I got on the program for the Garden State Film Festival because of that, and then have been asked to come on and host blocks of films. And this past year was really special. Because I got the picture's not up on my IMDb yet, but there is a picture of me with one of these guest stars that I got to meet. You might remember him as Butch Cavendish from The Legend of the Lone Ranger. How about Jim Ignatowski from Taxi? Oh, maybe you know him as Krug from Star Trek III, Search for Spock. Christopher Lloyd was on the program because Chris made a film just recently, which was shown for the first time at our film festival. And it's called Making a Killing. And it's a twisted modern day crime mystery based on a true story. And it's really neat. And he came to the convention, and there's a picture of me doing the Star Trek hand signal. And I wrote an audio. He asked for, you know, we talked about the makeup, you know, we had some conversation about, you know, putting on that makeup, and he right. went through, of course, he went through the whole process, which I didn't, which was interesting to hear. And I wrote the autograph to him, and I said to Chris, I have not had enough of you. And
that's a great way. That's a great one.
That's the autograph I gave Chris. And then he said, you know, Steve, I you're a voice actor. You do voices. Who do you do? I said, I do you. And that was a part of it.
That's a good Christopher Lloyd, too. That's a good one.
Okay, Kirk, I will give you okie dokie. Oh, wait, that's kind of a taxi.
It's crossing the streams there, right? Yeah.
They're crossing streams. Don't cross the streams.
Another franchise.
Oh, thank you.
No, I love Christopher Lloyd in Star Trek III. I think that's he's a very underrated Star Trek villain. And he's a great Klingon. His performance kind of defined Klingons for the rest of the Star Trek, really.
He really was not a nice guy. And that, you know, even Kirk, who he killed Kirk's son, just shows what kind of character, what kind of human being Kirk is. And that even when they were fighting, he wouldn't let him, you know, fall over and grab them to save him. He wouldn't let him go into the pit until he tried to pull him down. And then that's when he used the line that I kind of copied. Yeah. Yeah.
Christopher Lloyd, he has had so many iconic roles, you know. I mean, you mentioned Taxi, obviously Back to the Future, Doc Brown, right? Judge Doom from Who Framed Roger Rabbit. I mean, he's just an iconic presence. And so his Star Trek role really kind of falls on the wayside a lot, but it's great that, you know, he's still out there talking about it. You got a chance to meet him.
Well, one about the Star Trek role, I said, by the way, Chris, you know, I hosted the original conventions, and if it wasn't for me, you wouldn't be working. Oh, thanks a lot for that. I appreciate that, Steve. But he was so nice and so quiet and just gentlemanly. I can't tell you. I didn't know what to expect meeting this larger-than-life character. And he was so gracious. We're at the cocktail party where they were doing the red. I don't know why they made the red carpet the same night as the cocktail. There's a giant room when all the celebrities are there doing red carpet, and then there's like the high level fans that have paid, you know, the access to come there, and they have hors d'oeuvres and circulating food. And every time Chris went to put an hors d'oeuvre in his mouth, they would call him over. Oh, Chris, here's Xander Berkeley's here. We need your picture with Xander. And like, I don't think he ate anything that whole night. And it was just, I felt bad. He was so, so gentlemanly. So I got to talk to him, and I told him about one of my favorite roles. Two things. One, my daughter, as a kid, said that when they did the Inspector Gadget film, she thought that Christopher Lloyd would have been a better Gadget. And I told him that. And he said, that's very interesting. He hadn't thought of that. He says, I could see how I would have done that role, you know. And then I said, one of his other famous roles to me was that he was the scientist responsible for the Graboids. If you saw the very short-lived sci-fi channel, Tremors.
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah.
He was on that.
So he smiled broadly that because they only made like 9 episodes. It was so expensive. They were on, then they were off for 2 weeks, then they were on again. And the show didn't catch on. It just was too expensive or too difficult to produce those. But he was very pleased to know that I saw him in that role and that I appreciated his work in the role. And I said, yeah, to me, you know, I know everybody's going to say, oh, I loved you on Taxi. I know you were Doc Brown. I said, I'm shaking hands with the guy that invented the Graboids. That was cool to me. So,
no, actors really appreciate that when you zero in on something they're not as well known for. Back to the Future, Michael J. Fox, he's a great guy, right? It's like the same questions all the time.
I didn't do it to impress him. I did it because I really love Tremors, and I'm very disappointed. Kevin was trying to bring the film back, and they were going to do it.
They were going to do it, and they canceled it. Yeah, just recently.
I just got the note from somebody, and I said, "Are you kidding me?" You know, because that would have been. I was already tuned in. I was already tuned in. You know, waiting for it to come on. You know, so you never know. Anyway, so the film festival that I hosted then and met Chris Lloyd is doing another one. They've done it for you know, how many years already. This year was the 16th annual, so next year's 17th annual. And I will again be hosting films, and they're already, if you have filmmakers out there, people that are doing independent films, music videos, even writing original music composed for film, they're already taking entries. So look for the Garden State Film Festival online. At the www, I guess you don't have to say that anymore, GSFF, GardenStateFilmFestival.org, and find out how you can submit your film for consideration in the upcoming festival. And I'll be there hosting it and maybe get to host your film. Okay, hey, that's real good. If people want to attend the festival, please know that it's coming up March 2019 in Asbury Park, New Jersey, which is where Bruce Springsteen first played at a club called the Stone Pony. It's a standing room only kind of club, and hope to see you there March 28th through 31st, and maybe introduce one of your films. Okay, that's the plug that I got in. The other thing that I'm doing, is that I'm working with the studio that I work for, or not work for, that I do a lot of the voice work in. Is now starting a second arm called the Jam Room Communications. The studio is called the Jam Room Music Complex, and they record bands, and they've got an amazing studio with Newman. Hello, Newman. U87, U67 microphones. I've never sounded so good. It's the same microphone, by the way, that Mark Hamill uses when he records the Joker voice. I think he's done that for a couple of years now, 1 or 2 years he's been doing that.
Yeah, and, 25, yeah.
Yeah, 25. My gosh. Anyway, the microphone that he uses for those animations is the same microphone that I get to use. So I never have sounded so good as I sound in the Jam Room. And they're starting this Jam Room Communications, and I'm going to be the lead voice, meaning when somebody wants a commercial, I'm the first one that they're going to think of to do narration, straight narration, character voices. And of course, we're building a stable of voices. And I'm pleased to say that one of my friends for years, actually, she's my ex-wife, is going to be doing voices, Lori Draz. And Lori and I were married, actually, 372 times, I think.
So that's a fascinating number. 370. Now you can't just leave that out there. You got to explain that now, Steve.
Okay. So Lori and I were not really married 372 times. And when we do it together on stage, she corrects me. She says, you know, 373. You know, we'll always change the number up. Lori and I work together at a radio station in, by the way, beautiful Asbury Park, New Jersey, in downtown Asbury Park, New Jersey, like beautiful downtown Burbank. And whenever they needed a husband and wife voice for commercials, it was always Lori and I. So we did that many commercials. We lost count how many we did. Like, hey, honey, have you seen my golf clubs? Oh, and then she'd be the smart one always. Oh, go to Golf World. Golf World has a sale, you know, and we would do that. So that's the gag that we were married. So Lori is going to be the female, the first female voice in the troupe. And she's just marvelous. And we are as close as you could be probably without actually having been married.
Well, that's great.
Years.
You guys have that rapport and history working together. You know, I'm sure that brings a lot to any project.
It does. It makes it so easy when you step up to the microphone. We know each other's timing, and don't step on lines or step on each other's lines when you have to, which sometimes is very funny. And she's got a great sense of timing.
Well, Steve, this has been a lot of fun. Are there any final words you want to leave the listeners with? I know we have our call to action for anyone who attended conventions in the 70s, but anything beyond that you want to leave us with as we wrap it up?
Well, nothing. Well, you know, I could use the goofy thing and, you know, say, you know, live long and prosper, and you have been and always shall be. But really what I want to just say is thank you to you, to the fans that keep this show alive, that I get to touch every once in a while, like hosting the film that Adam made and getting to meet Christopher Lloyd. I could not do this without your love and constant support of this little movie that we did called Star Trek, the Motion Picture. And thank you for remembering me and thinking about me. Do stay in touch. If you've been to one of those conventions, get in touch with me. And just thank you. That's probably all I want to say, humbly.
All right. Well, it's been a lot of fun talking to Stephen Lance and reminiscing about the good old days of Star Trek conventions and Star Trek Motion Picture over the last couple of weeks. But that's not the only thing we've been talking about on Trek FM. Here's a quick look at what else you might have missed elsewhere on the network.
Previously on Trek.fm, Literary Treks.
I wouldn't say it's totally different, but I would say there's some difference to it. Yeah, I did see some elements that reminded me of The Trouble with Tribbles. And yeah, you know, certainly I mud in a piece of the action. I can see that too. It does have that comedy element, just like those episodes do. But I think this takes it a little further and is a little more slapstick.
Yeah, very slapstick.
But again, there's certain tones and certain elements that do remind me of those other episodes. So,
Warp 5.
I do want to mention also that just something that this came up when I was working on Knights of the Living Dead. George Romero hated the word zombie and didn't think of his creatures as zombies. But,
yes.
And it's one of the reasons why there's only some overlap between what we saw in Knights of the Living Dead and everything you just described from West African and Caribbean folklore. Because of that, the two, basically, you kind of got, you know, undead peanut butter and zombie chocolate, and you wound up with what everybody now thinks of as zombies.
Meta Treks.
Just imagine the worst case scenario that could happen, and look at all the bad things that have happened in history, and then you realize, hey, even if the worst possible scenario unfolds, that's not too bad in the grand scheme of things right here in the present.
I was going to say, some people read Marcus Aurelius, Riker goes to the holodeck.
The 602 Club.
I definitely agree. I thought that the writer did a great job of portraying Han. And Han's a hard character to nail down because I think it was really hit and miss in the old legend stuff with Han. There were some books that really glorified him as a character and tried to turn him into something that he wasn't.
And that's what else is happening on Trek.fm.
So check out these shows and find out what we're talking about in your favorite corner of the Star Trek universe and beyond. You'll find us wherever you get your podcasts. If you're an Apple user, get the show on iTunes or the Apple Podcasts app. Be sure to hit the subscribe button. That helps us out greatly and makes it easier for other listeners to find the show. If you're not an Apple user, we've got you covered as well. You can find our shows on Stitcher, TuneIn, Speaker, SoundCloud, Windows Phone, and of course, you can stream and download the MP3 file from our website and grab the RSS link as well.
If you would like to get in touch with us here at Trek FM, you can always find us on trekfm.com/contact and look in the sidebar on the show page. Or you can go to speakpipe.com/trekfm and please leave us a voice message. You can also contact us through Twitter at trekfm, Facebook at facebook.com/trekfm, and the Babel Conference. Type the Babel Conference, that's B-A-B-E-L, into the search field on Facebook, or go to our website at trekfm and click discussion on the menu bar.
Another way you can help us keep all of our shows coming to you each week is to become a patron of the network on Patreon. If you visit patreon.com/trekfm, that's patreon.com/trekfm, you'll find our current goals and different milestone contribution levels along with all the great perks we have for you. These perks include early access to content, exclusive content, producer credits, seats on our content development team, and more. We really appreciate any support you can give us and hope you'll join the team. Again, you'll find all the details at patreon.com/trekfm.
Speaking of Patreon, thank you as always to our associate producers for Standard Orbit. Norman C. Lau, Nicholas Anastasio, Tim Robertson, Richard Marquez, Corey Elrod, and Dan Rhodes. Thank you so much, guys.
As for me, you can find me on Twitter at MoronZach, that's MoreOnCach. I'm also the host of my own podcast, Always Holding On to Smallville, where we talk about each and every episode of that Young Superman show. You can find us on Twitter at AlwaysMallville with one S.
You can find me on Twitter. I am at Trekkie01D.
Celebrating Trek Tuesdays. That's tomorrow, everybody. Wear your Trek.
Yes, and use the hashtag Trek Tuesday.
So thanks, everyone, for listening, and join us again next time here on Trek FM for another episode of Standard Orbit.